Hey guys, my name is Denver Riddle. I'm a colorist and filmmaker, and if you're wondering how can I make the look of my films stand out through color grading in Premiere Pro CC and make my films look big budget, well, I'm gonna reveal that here in this beginner crash course using the Lumetri color tools found in Adobe. We're gonna create this amazing look. You can download the look as a LUT or lookup table and easily apply this to your own footage. Also, while YouTube is a fantastic resource for learning about so many different kinds of subjects, if you are looking for a step-by-step guide that takes you all the way through discovering the art of color grading and getting the big Hollywood film looks, I wanna let you know about a free training workshop I'm gonna be doing where I reveal my top color grading secrets. So to attend, just click the link below in the description and I hope to see you there. All right, let's do this thing. Here inside, let's set up our workspace for color grading. We'll choose color workspace and that will bring up the Lumetri color tools. In the top section, we have the scopes. We have the program panel where we see the clip we're currently working on and the Lumetri color panel here over on the side where we can perform our color grading. It's also worth pointing out the effects control panel where we can do some other things, including adding and tracking color masks, but more on that in a bit. Before we jump in and start grading this thing, let's discuss basic terminology for how we define color. The three basic terms that we use to define color are hue, saturation, and luma. Hue is the name we call colors, saturation is the intensity or vividness of a hue, and luma is the brightness or shade of hue. It's also important to know how to read the scopes, which can be super beneficial. If you're in the color workspace, the scopes should appear, but if not, just click on the Lumetri scopes tab. The three scopes I always use are the waveform, the RGB parade, and the vector scope. The waveform lets us correct for exposure. If I overlay an image on top of the waveform, you can see that the trace, the stuff you see here, actually corresponds with the image of the girl dancing. The RGB parade scope is helpful for correcting white balance issues. It reads similar to the waveform, other than it's broken out into the individual color channels of red, green, and blue. With this scope, it makes it easier to spot imbalances if either the image is too cool or too warm. How that will show is one channel elevated above the other. The vector scope corresponds directly with the color wheel, and I've overlaid it here for convenience. It shows what colors are in the image, as well as their saturation. The further the trace extends from the center of the scope, the more saturated or vivid the colors are. Here's a simple but powerful workflow for color correction. We first correct the exposure or brightness of the image. Second, the white balance or color temperature if there are any issues. And lastly, the saturation by either increasing or reducing it. This will make more sense as we actually do it. Let's first make a correction to the exposure of this image using the basic correction panel. Now, if you look at the controls in the basic corrections panel, you'll see controls for highlights and shadows, but also for whites and blacks. Lumetri uses a terminology that's slightly different than other grading applications, but here's how the controls work. The blacks control adjusts the darkest parts or the very bottom darkest point. And the whites control adjusts the brightest or the very top of the image. Now, the shadows control affects the tonal range between the shadows and the midtones, if say you want to recover or darken detail in the shadow areas. And the highlights control affects the tonal range between the highlights and the midtones or the upper part of the image if, say again, you want to recover or brighten details in the highlight areas. We'll adjust the shadows first with the blacks control while watching the waveform. We want to bring the trace and the shadows down until the darkest parts of the image sit right above zero. Then we'll bring up the highlights with the whites control so the brightest parts of the trace sits right about here near the top. Then let's darken the undertones or the area between the shadows and the midtones by pulling the shadow slider to the left. This will help us remove the washed out look from the talent's face. And then I'll just adjust this a little more until we have good contrast and exposure. This is the first step. Next, we'll fix the color temperature since the image is looking a bit cool. Looking at the RGB parade scope, you can see that the blue trace is elevated above the red and green. Our goal is to neutralize or white balance the whites, and we'll want to find something in the image that is white. In this case, we're going to use her sneakers as a reference. Now, we can do this manually with the temperature and tint sliders, or we can save some time and use Premiere's Auto White Balance Selector. To do that, we just need to select and click on the white part of the image, and voila! The temperature and tint sliders automatically move to white balance the shot, and the traces are aligned in the RGB parade scope. Now, if for whatever reason we're not happy with the result, we can still manually adjust those sliders to our liking. In this case, I think we can warm up the image a little bit. And that's the second step. As our final step, let's boost the color a little bit by increasing the saturation. And here's what the clip looks like before and after the correction. Pretty amazing, right? On the next shot, we'll repeat the same procedure, going for a nice balance of exposure with the blacks, whites, shadows, and highlights controls. The color temperature in the shot looks off too, so we'll use the white balance eyedropper, this time over the truck in the background. I'll then refine it a little manually. Lastly, we'll just add some saturation. Moving to the third shot, we want to match it to the first shot for obvious reasons, since this is pretty much a wide version of the same scene. To give us a good starting point, let's copy the correction from the first clip to this one. We'll go to the first shot, select it, and use the keyboard shortcut Command-C if you're on a Mac, or Control-C if you're on Windows, and we'll then go back to this clip. We'll right-click on it and choose Paste Attributes from the drop-down menu. We'll make sure the Lumetri color effect is checked and click OK. This copies the correction and gives us a good starting point, but you'll see that we still have some matching issues. The image is too dark. To help with matching, we can go to the color wheels and match panel and activate the comparison view. Now we can see a side-by-side comparison of our clip and any other clip in the timeline. There are also vertical and horizontal split options, but we'll stick to the side-by-side option. Now here's the really cool thing. In the side-by-side view, we can compare them visually and in the scopes to make matching a breeze. To match the traces better, we'll bring up the general exposure using the exposure slider, and then bring up the shadows with the blacks control. We can see now in the waveform that both traces look like they're at the same level. That's a nice looking match. Now let's disable the comparison view option. In the interest of time, I've already gone ahead and performed color correction to these remaining clips. But in this last shot, you'll see that the yellow pole looks greenish compared to the ones in the other shots. Well, what's really cool is that with Lumetri, we can fix that one color. So let's open the HSL secondary panel. And then with the eyedropper, let's click and drag through the pole to qualify it. To see what we've selected, let's turn on the highlight feature by clicking here. Now clearly our selection isn't enough. So let's improve our selection with the hue, saturation, and luma sliders. Then add just a little denoise and blur to soften the key. Okay, now let's turn the highlight feature off. We'll then drag the color wheels control until the pole loses that green tone. And bam! Dunsky! As a final touch, her face is looking a little dark, so to lighten it, we'll accomplish that using a mask, where we're effectively relighting the scene. Something really cool that we can do in post. Now, in order to do this using Lumetri, we'll need to add a second instance. To do that, go to the project panel, we'll see a double arrow located at the upper right side. Go ahead and click on that and choose Effects from the drop-down menu. Once we find the Lumetri color effect, we'll drag it to the Effect Control panel. And this adds a second instance of Lumetri where we can now use a shape mask. I'll go ahead and add a mask and size and position it over her face like so. I'll then add some feathering so this doesn't stand out too much. Then to lighten her face, we'll increase the shadows and highlights. Playing it back, you can see that the talent's face moves, so this is gonna be a problem. To address that, we'll wanna track the shape to her face, so going to the Effects Control panel, we can easily do this by clicking on the Track Forward button. And bada bing, bada bang. The shape moves perfectly with the movement of our talent's face. Really amazing stuff. I love doing color grading in Premiere Pro CC. Okay, now it's time for the really fun part, and that's creating an awesome look for these clips. The orange teal look is a really popular look because it uses principles of color contrast to make the skin tones advance or pop out from the background. And frankly, it just looks awesome, so you're going to love this. Now I'm gonna show you a quick way to apply the same look on top of all of these clips, and this will save you so much time and ensure that you have a consistent look across the board. To do that, we'll go to the project panel, right-click, and select from the drop-down menu. Choose new item, then adjustment layer. A prompt will appear, and we'll just click OK. We'll drag the adjustment layer to the second video layer over top of our video clips, and any adjustments or color treatments we apply here will be applied to all the clips underneath this adjustment layer. Pretty sweet, huh? All right, now let's create the look. Make sure the adjustment layer is selected, and we're gonna skip and go straight past the basic correction panel to the curves, where we'll have more creative control. Now, a quick crash course on the way this works, in case you haven't already used these in Photoshop, the bottom point adjusts the shadows, the top point adjusts the highlights, and then we can make as many points on the curve in between where we can shape the tonal range. In this case, we don't want to affect the highlights or shadows too much, so we'll create contrast in between these areas known as the undertones and midtones. I'll make a point here in the midtones and drag it up. This improves our exposure, but makes the undertones look a little washed out. So let's add another point here and drag it down to adjust the density of the undertones. There, that's looking nice. Now we have much richer contrast. For color, we need to push teal into the overall image, but without affecting the skin tones. So let me show you how we'll do this. We'll go to the HSL secondary panel and use the eyedropper to select our talent skin. We'll then refine our selection with the Hue, Sat, and Luma sliders. Then add some denoise and blur for good measure. Then what we need to do, since we currently have our skin tone selected, is to actually invert our selection like so. And now we can use the color wheels to introduce teal into the image without affecting our skin tones. Now we're onto something, right? But we're not there yet. Something is off. Because we pushed teal into the entire tonal range, our shadows also look teal. So we want to actually clean them up so that we have clean black shadows. To do that, I'm going to show you a really awesome trick. I'll add another instance of Lumetri, go to the Hue Saturation Curves panel, then go to the Lumiverse Sat Curve. Now the way this tool works is the shadows are to the left and the highlights are to the right, and then anywhere that we place points on the curve, we're able to adjust the saturation for just that part of the tonal range by either pulling up to increase the saturation or pulling down to decrease it. So this is a really cool way for selectively reducing the saturation in the shadows without affecting anything else. So we'll place a point here so that nothing above is affected, and then we'll drag the left point all the way down to reduce the saturation in the shadows. And voila, our shadows are nice and clean, and the skin tones and everything else above keeps their saturation. If I toggle this instance of Lumetri off and back on, you can see the difference it made in pulling the teal just out of the shadows on the wall, her hair, and the trash can. Okay, so don't forget that cool trick. Now, just to play with these yellow poles, to have them have a more closer match to her coat and her skin tones, going for more of an orange teal look, we'll go to the Hue Saturation Curves panel. And under the Hue vs. Hue curve, we'll use the eyedropper to isolate just the yellow range and drag it up to introduce more warmth into the poles. As a final touch, I want to apply one of the LUTs from Ascend that's available for download when you sign up for the free workshop. Let's add another instance of Lumetri and go to the Creative panel. From here, we can browse our LUTs and I'll choose the 3-strip LUT. Now, at first it's too strong, but that's okay because we can dial it back to taste with the intensity slider. What an awesome look. Now, if any of this has seemed overwhelming to you, I want to let you know about a great alternative that we've developed as a plugin. For content creators who don't want to specialize as a colorist, but still need a professional look with on-screen grading, Lightroom-style controls, false color mode for landing the correct exposure, and real-time previews with LUTs and presets, you can find out more about CinemaGrade. I'll have a link for it in the description below. So that's just an alternative. Now, I know that we covered a lot of things here, but my purpose was to help you get started with seeing a difference in your films today. If you're looking for more guided help in discovering the power of color grading, I want to invite you to our 1-hour color grading workshop where I reveal the top color grading secrets used in Hollywood and how best to do color grading in Premiere Pro CC. You'll find a link to register for the workshop in the description below this video. In the web class, I reveal how I went from being a wedding videographer down to zero wedding bookings during the recession of 2008 to improving the look of my films and landing client work with some of the biggest brands like Facebook. I reveal the same techniques that have had the biggest impact on my career. So if you're serious and you want to be guided every step of the way, you don't want to miss it. I also want to point out that if you want to learn more about our Color Grading Academy, it's the only way that you can do that. People ask us if we do formal training. Well, this is your opportunity to discover that, and we'll have a special offer for it at the end of the presentation. So be sure to save your seat, click the subscribe button, and then the bell for more grading videos. I hope that you enjoyed this beginner crash course as much as I enjoyed creating it for you, and I look forward to seeing you at the training. Have a great day.